As always, announcements, and we invite you to stay after the service for coffee and conversation. Enjoy a cup of coffee and some sweet treats, and then head off to the Sunday school classes. One adult class in the ministry center, one adult class in the conference room. Youth will be upstairs, and children also upstairs. Choir practice is on Thursday. We're doing pretty well, but there's still a few seats available. And join us. Speak with Rosemary. I'm not sure what this slide is about. Somebody's going to have to help me out, but it looks like Kendall.
Kendall and Haley, they were on Facebook for Kendall had an award. I don't know what. They placed well in Cochran meet yesterday, so.
Well, congratulations.
We hadn't seen the runners. So.
Youth group under the leadership of Andrea has been restarted, and we invite you to come this evening from 5 to 7 and to bring your Bible. And continue to pray for Impact on Union City and meetings. What would the church do without administrative meetings? Tomorrow evening, the NOW committee will be meeting. On the 5th, SPRC will be meeting. On the 10th, trustees, 17th, church council, and 17th, very important, our very first charge conference as a global Methodist church. The interesting thing about a charge conference is everyone is welcome, everyone has voice, but only those who are members of church council have vote. But we certainly welcome everyone's input in making our decision.
And it will be led by Matt Judge and Pastor Price.
It will be led by Pastor Matt Judge, a former United Methodist pastor. Matt is a fantastic young pastor. And, pardon?
That's relative.
Matt? Am I thinking of his son?
I don't know, but Matt is older than I am, so he's not quite.
Oh my gosh. Well, he's still young at heart. All right.
Matt is true.
Still young at heart. And other announcements. Clothing drive and shoe drive. Again, if you wish to contribute any of your donations to the wildfires, hurricanes, earthquakes, flooding, all those disasters that are going on around the country and around the world, you can do so by putting a memo with your check as to which relief effort it would go to. And Samaritan's Purse.
It'll be set up next week.
Okay, but I believe we have
it. It was going to be this Sunday.
I know.
Pat's going to do an announcement, and then when she's done, a video.
Yes.
Oh. Okay.
You can hold the prop.
So.
We have a rehearsal.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Since this is the first day of October, I'd like to help you with ideas for your Christmas shopping. Yes. Anyway, actually, I am representing our church outreach committee called NOW with a mission moment. You've heard us talking about the Operation Christmas Child, the shoeboxes that are involved, and maybe you've filled some of those yourselves in the past. If so, thank you. And if not, here we go. This is an Operation Christmas Child shoebox. It measures 6 by 11 by 4.5 inches. The measurements are important to know because your gifts must fit inside. Many people are hesitant because I don't know what to put in there, or I can't afford to buy more presents. Here are some guidelines. Number one, get anything that will bring a smile to a child's face. Blair's going to be putting out some suggested gift lists, and they'll provide ideas for the ages and sex and what you can't send. Number two, it must fit in the box, so that's where the measurements come in. As far as the cost is concerned, here's one of the boxes that I'm sending, and the cost totaled somewhere between 10 $5. Walmart and Dollar Tree were my go-tos, and let's see what that amount bought.
How do you think, Joe?
First of all, God works in wondrous ways. I said that I would really like to add something in these boxes that would represent, you know, the church. Like, we're going to look at toys and stuff, and that's very important. That's what these kids don't have. But also, I wanted them to be introduced to, you know, Bible things. And so I was looking on Oriental Trading, and I found this lovely activity pad. It's like 48 pages of stuff, mostly without words, because you don't know where these boxes are going to end up. But a lot of Christian figures, characters, so they can color them and, you know, just look at them and learn things. And the problem was the shipment was not going to happen until next week, naturally. And somehow the FedEx person came 2 days ago with my big box of 120 of these pads. So this was awesome. And I was so excited because they really are wonderful. And so every single box that we sent from this church will have one of these in there so the kids can enjoy
that. Pat, will you pull this speaker closer to your face?
Can you hear me? Is that better? I don't know. I don't want to break it. That's better than these people.
Sorry. The new sound system will be installed next week.
Oh, next week. Okay. Well, God works in mysterious ways.
Yes.
Anyway, I'm also including a note, and I would encourage anyone that's going into a box, just a little note saying, God loves you, or we're thinking of you, or something like that. Anyway, here are the things that Mark's going to put in the bag here. I'm sending toothbrushes, they're cute, a little notebook that they can just do anything in, and this is kind of special, so when you watch the video after this, think of this thing. So, colored pencils, squishy pad, just something we can play with. Every child needs a sloth. Sunglasses, not the typical, but sunglasses, pretty cute. Some flip-flops, colorful. I designed them to be a little girl in mind. I'm not exactly sure the age, but something young. Here's a little headgear, very cute. Socks, colorful ones. A little Minnie Mouse figurine to play with. Set of checkers. I think checkers are pretty much world type. A Peppa Pig puzzle. It's only got 24 pieces. And here's a coloring book, and it's not a religious one, but it's got figures mostly instead of, you know, much talking, so I thought that was kind of important, and they can use that. And that is my box. And as I say, it's only 10 or 20 bucks, and I went to the stores that I mentioned. Starting in January, we're going to be asking for specific items all year long. Like in January, it might be toys that you can get on sale from Christmas. And we're going to have an ongoing collection. So every, you know, all the way up through the next year is November. But this year, since we only have a month and a half before the official Samaritan's Purse Collection Week in November, we're asking that you fill your own box, like I did this, this one. I said box or boxes, okay? And we provide the box, all you do is fill it. Our goal by November 13th, and we can do this, is 50 boxes, yes? Yes, 50 boxes. And if you have any questions about this wonderful outreach, please see me or anybody on the NOW committee, Blair especially. And if after my haranguing you still think you're not interested, please join me in watching what one shoebox meant to one movie.
My name is Jolene, and I grew up in one of the smallest islands on the south of the island of the Philippines. I grew up in an area close to a dump site. I remember my dad lifting his truck. I often watched my younger siblings and skip school, so my mom could go to the dump site and look for things that she can sell to buy us food. I remember my dad, Bill, he built a house. He called it a house. It's just a house that we live. It's made of cardboard. Because of our situation, I've never received a gift as a kid. We couldn't even afford my food for us. We lived alone just for birthdays and Christmas. sister started going to this church nearby. I remember I went after her one time, and the pastor of that church invited me to come help them. I happened to help out the people handing out shoeboxes to the kids in the neighborhood, including my sister. Every time I hand shoeboxes to the kids, there's a glimpse in my heart that I hope I can get one too. The only thing that was towards the end, a lady came up to me and gave me the extra shoes. I just felt so loved. Everything on the shoebox were very special to me. So it's the first gift I ever received, and most around Christmas. And seeing new items like notebooks and pencils, it was amazing. Now my life is different. I am forever grateful and blessed to be able to pack a shoebox with my husband and my girls. The feeling of giving back and knowing that this box represents the faith of a child.
We have a couple other announcements. Blair first, and then Kevin.
I don't know about you, but that was really moving to me. There's so many children who have nothing, and we have so much. Please consider helping us bring joy. I want to thank Pat. She has a real enthusiasm for this, and she's done a lot of research, and I really thank you for that. On the table where the Operation Christmas Child stuff will be next week are the apparel items that you purchased with the Global on it. I have them all in bags and tagged with your name. If you are so inclined to buy something at this point, you can just go through Lori Coleman down at Coleman's Apparel. She does like orders to be prepaid, but you know, if you see them and think, why didn't I order one, you can still go through Lori personally. As far as the clothing drive that we saw, we did take a first batch. Connie, I believe, took it up. And I...
Brenda
took it up. Thank you. But next week will be the deadline to bring in anything apparel-wise, clothing-wise. And another thing you're going to be hearing from Pat is a plea to help us with the harvest dinner. It's coming up on November 3rd, and she's already recruiting, and I appreciate that. So, lots going on, but this church always comes through, and I appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you.
Not sure how well I'm going to do following these girls, but... This is on behalf of the trustees. We have a number of projects that are ongoing right now around the church and the parsonage. The most noticeable recent one, for those of you who enter the sanctuary via the ramp over here on the east side, you'll notice that there were some changes made this last week to the ramp itself. That the stub wall is gone, and there is a bare spot on the floor. We thought that was going to get covered with carpet this past week, but it didn't happen. We expect it to happen this week. And just so you know, the reason we've done that, we've had a number of funeral events in the church. that have always required carrying the casket up and down the stairs, which is a pretty risky event both directions. We've eliminated that stub wall on the ramp to accommodate being able to get caskets in and out of the sanctuary without carrying them. We should be able to get around the corner easily now. And we just wanted to let you know that it is obviously for the benefit of everyone who comes into this place. And also want to remind you that if you have difficulty going up and down stairs and don't want to use the ramp, we do have an elevator that works very well. If you need help using the elevator, we are more than glad to have someone assist you. So this is a little improvement to the building as a whole that we hope is going to help everyone going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin, for that update. Sean, you still want to make a comment?
Might as well. I gotta get something first, so hold on. So as I was preparing my comments here this morning, obviously things have kind of changed. You throw the shoebox out there. I'm curious, how big is your shoebox? What have you got? What have you received? And I want to make a little bit of a plea. This is not me shaking anybody down for anything. It's passing along the reality of church finances, right? This building, the structure, the staff, the projects, everything that we do, the utilities, they're my bills. They're part of my responsibility. And, I just want to let you know, we need more. We need a little more. If you look in the Bible, there's a lot of discussion about money. And, you might be there going, man, how can I give more? How can I do more? I mean, inflation's taking a bite out of everything I do. The grocery store's trying to shake me down, whatever it is. But I'm telling you, it's a little joke, right? Yes. I don't know. So, a little bit of humor in that. But, on behalf of the finances of the church, I just want to pass along that the church needs a raise. We just moved money from our investment funds over into our operating funds, and that's not a great trajectory to be on. As we become Global Methodist and rejuvenate and, relaunch our church, I would hope that you can look at, what you're giving to this church to help, keep it here. And, my kind of joking comment was, I shouldn't need Mark to lift this up, right? And I know that there are people that are, faithfully giving, if you're online, if you're here in person, but I just want you to be aware of where the church is. Each month it's kind of touch and go with being able to pay the bills, and we want to be able to have a robust buffer. We want to be able to, do things that help people out. We want to be able to reach people that need us. I just want you to think about that today. Sorry. You can't take it with you. And we can go buy any toy that we want. We can go spend our money however we want. But does God have your heart to do something? Have you had something great happen to you this year? Did you get a raise? Did you get a bonus? Did something unexpected happen in your life that maybe you can make a difference in this church? This isn't to condemn anybody here. It's just to let you know the church needs a raise. And we would appreciate it if you'd consider that. We don't pass these around, and maybe out of sight is out of mind, but maybe we should start passing around so that we feel that.
Well,
We're working. But remember, God's looking for us too. He looks out for us, you know, a little bit back.
God does provide.
He does provide. Thank you.
Thanks for the pre-planning of my service.
This is going to be a long one, Mark.
Oh, it is. I guess my apologies for a long period of announcements, but it's good to know what goes on in the life of the church. Our church life is not just about this worship service, but the ministry that takes place from in between the Sundays
and
is the most important role of what
we do.
How
alive the church is.
Exactly. So thank you for your patience on that. I hesitate to ask, are there any other It is a wonderful day that we have gathered together to celebrate Holy Communion and to hear the Word of God proclaimed and ask God to speak to each of us, to encourage us, to maybe scold us a little bit, to be the people that He has called us to be. Let us pray together. Oh Lord God, what a beautiful morning this has turned out to be. First we saw the bright moon and then the dense fog. Kind of emblematic of sometimes how our life is. But now as the fog has lifted and the sun is shining brightly, it also reminds us of what a great and awesome God you are, that you rely on us, but more importantly, we rely on you. We rely on you to show us what we should do and how we should do it, and you give us the strength. And so as we worship this morning, be present with us. Speak to us, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now, as you are able, and so led, if you would care to stand and sing and join with us as we sing our two opening songs, Rock of Ages and Let Your Mercy Reign.
Rock, there is no God like us.
Of seeing friends and family, a cup of coffee, a nice sweet treat. But mostly we have come together seeking your presence, seeking your presence with us in this place, speaking to us, inspiring us, challenging us. And as we leave this place, we pray that we feel that your Spirit has indeed been with us to challenge us, to comfort us, to inspire us. That as we walk through our daily lives, people might see you through us. You are indeed an awesome God, a God who created all that is and ever will be. Be with us, Lord, and may we be your faithful witnesses. As we come together this morning, we have some very specific prayers. Bree has asked that we pray for her grandson, Henry. He's having another surgery. So we pray that you would be with the doctors and nurses, those that minister to him, that it might be a successful surgery. And we continue to pray for Scarlett, the great-granddaughter of Carol Stockwell, Carol Sayers. The recurrence of the leukemia is causing an urgent need for stem cells. It would appear that her younger 4-year-old sister is eligible, but it is a delicate surgery, and we just ask that you would be present and all that, that healing might come to her young body. This morning, Lord, we also pray for Jordan Farringer. Had a trip to the ER last night and realized having appendicitis. So today is having an appendectomy at St. Vincent. We just again ask that you would be the doctors and nurses, all those that minister to her. May she be healed and back to work soon. We pray for all who are recovering from surgeries. It is just so amazing, Lord, how in our country in this day and age, how blessed we are. The doctors can replace worn out joints, make bypasses to where there are blockages and weaknesses. We give you our praise, and we pray for those who are recovering from the various diseases. Lord, we pray for those who continue to be in mourning, for the loss of loved ones, or for broken relationships. the loss of a job, all those things that could cause us to be deeply depressed. We just call upon you to be present in those individuals' lives that they might find hope. As always, we pray for our politicians. As we've watched the news this week of the goings-on in Washington, we sometimes wonder, we often wonder, are there really any statesmen who serve? And for the wars around the world, we pray for those who wage war that their hearts might be changed and they would seek peace. For those who have been affected by the weather, be present in their lives. As we watch the video of those young children getting a shoebox full of ordinary items, the joy that it brings, Lord, lay that burden upon our hearts. And as always, Lord, we pray for our pastor as he seeks to be the leader of this congregation, and for this congregation, for the many ministries that take place. We are so blessed. We ask that you would continue to give us the means and the challenge to be your hands and feet in this community. As we go forward in this service, looking to celebrate Holy Communion, may we be very mindful that it is not just a piece of bread dipped into a cup of juice, but all that it represents. Lord, there are things that have remained on our heart, and we lay them before you, knowing that you hear them, and we just ask, and lay those things that have remained unspoken, we lay them before you, knowing that you answer. We pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. This morning's anthem is a communion hymn, Table of Mercy. Very powerful words. Table of Mercy, Table of Grace. Our musical offering this morning.
mentioned, and I want to do that before I read the scripture. Thursday morning, we had Meet You or See You at the Pole at the school for gathering and prayer. And Brady was one of the student leaders, so good job. Good job. Wanted to point that out, and it was probably as many adults as students, but it was good, and I had the chance to pray with Nate and Kim and as teachers, and that was a great honor. Great honor. So keep our students and our schools in your prayers all year long. All year long. Our scripture for today comes from Exodus chapter 17, verses 1 through 7. Hear these words. The whole Israelite community set out from the desert of Sin, traveling from place to place as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. So they quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses replied, "And why do you quarrel with me? Why do you put the Lord to the test?" But the people were thirsty for water there, and they grumbled against Moses. They said, "Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to make us and our children and livestock die of thirst?" And Moses cried out to the Lord, "What am I to do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord answered Moses, "Walk on ahead of the people, take with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. I will stand there before you by the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it for the people to drink." So Moses did this in the sight of the elders of Israel. And he called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and because they tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" May God bless the reading and hearing of these holy words, the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to stand as you are able, and we are going to sing 641, "Fill My Cup, Lord." We're going to sing it twice. So please stand as you are able. Shows an earnest
would make it as if this accident had never happened.
How many have prayed that? Kids? Yeah, no?
The third frame shows the kid with one eye open, looking to see if God answered the prayer. However, the window and the vase were still broken. And in the final frame, with hands still folded, both eyes open, rolled towards heaven, as we read the words, "And you'll wonder why participation in the church is down." You know, and at first it's funny. It is funny. We look at it with a chuckle, but as we give it a second thought, it's sad. It's sad. And the sadness comes because, unfortunately, there are far too many people in the world, even in the church, who only see God like that child, as a magic genie or a fairy godmother to be called upon when we have a wish to be granted or a need to be met. We human beings tend to want what we want when we want it. We call upon God to state our demands. We put God to the test, and when things do not turn out the way that we want them, we turn our backs, feeling as if God has failed us. We didn't get what we wanted, so we forget God. At least until the next time that we need something or need someone to blame. I never cease to be amazed at how quick people are to use the name of God to curse and to blame, yet how hesitant they are to use God's name in praise. Humanity's problem of looking at God like the comic strip child is not something new. It's been going on for years and years. Past few weeks, we've been taking a look at the Exodus. And I'm sure that you have noticed in the Exodus story that the Israelites are complaining about everything. Something they continue throughout their entire wilderness journey. On the shores of the Red Sea, they whine to Moses. Was it because there were not enough graves in Egypt that you've taken us away to die in the wilderness? And after God provided a path for the nation of Israel by parting the Red Sea so they could escape the Egyptian army, and after God returned the sea to its place and they saw the dead soldiers on the seashore, they showed no gratitude. And no sooner had they gotten to the other side of the sea, and they start complaining to Moses and Aaron, the food rations that they brought with them were running low. They're running out, so they mutter against Moses that he brought them out to starve. So, God provides manna every morning and enough on the sixth day to feed them on the Sabbath. And each evening, God provided quail as well, so that they had both bread and meat to eat. While I was in college, a friend was taking an Old Testament course and had to outline the book of Exodus. When she's about halfway through, she comes storming into the room and said that the Israelites were just a bunch of whiners and complainers, and she didn't know why God just didn't wipe them out. And she was mad. She was mad. And when you read through Exodus, even just the first 16 chapters, you understand where she's coming from. Although God asked to provide for the people numerous times, in each time of need, they grow less grateful and more rebellious. Which is the case in our passage for this morning. They've been wandering through the desert, arriving at Rephidim, which translates resting place, perfect choir number, resting place, which, you know, and the problem was that this resting place had no water, and the people were thirsty. So what happens? They did the same thing that they've been doing the whole trip. They grumbled, demanding that Moses give them water to drink. Moses asked them why they were putting God to the test. After all they had been through thus far, you would think that they would have figured out that God would provide for their basic needs. But instead, they continue to grumble, asking Moses why he had led them out of Egypt to die of thirst. They were getting angry. Moses was afraid they're going to stone him. So he asked God, "What do I do?" And when he's told to strike a rock with his staff, he does as God has commanded him. And water springs forth from that rock, providing all the water that they need. Now, if you were to continue reading through the book of Exodus, you would find other stories of the Israelites grumbling, because they did it all the time. And it makes you wonder, why were they so ungrateful and demanding? Whenever they were faced with a new challenge on their journey, they totally forgot about all those times that God had provided for them in the past. Instead of believing that God would again provide for their needs, they would put God to the test one more time. Instead of following God's commands, they would do what they wanted to do and then wonder why they had problems. Sound familiar? We're not much different. Think about how many times we put God to the test, forgetting all that God has provided for us, forgetting about what's in our shoebox already. Think about how often we human beings go to God like the child in the comic strip. We have disobeyed God. We have disobeyed God's commandments, and we have made a mess of our lives and our world. We demand that God take away the brokenness that we have created. And when our prayers are not answered, we either grumble because they were not answered the way that we wanted them to be answered, or we soon forget how God has provided for our needs. That is, until we create another major mess and where we once again, you know, have to go to God to ask for help, to put God to the test. That is not the life we are called to live. We are called to live lives of faith. the God who so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son to die on a cross will always be with us, will always provide for us. We are called to follow God, and considering how much that God has provided and is still providing for us, we'd have to be crazy to want to test God. Crazy. God has so loved us, yet we continue to doubt. God has so loved us that he sent his one and only Son, but we still doubt. As we gather at the Lord's table today, we gather with brothers and sisters in Christ all around the world. It's World Communion Sunday. We're lifting up what unites us as people of faith, and that is Jesus Christ, crucified and resurrected. The sacrifice that he gave for us. The way God provided a way of salvation for us. From our everyday physical needs to our need of redemption and salvation through the suffering, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God has provided for us and provides for us still. As we gather at the Lord's table today, think about your shoebox and just how full it is. How God has blessed you with so much. And how God provided a means of salvation. As Mark mentioned, it's not just some bread and juice. This is a reminder of what God has done for us. How God has provided for us and provides for us still. And as you are reminded of God's provision, may you share with the world what he has provided for you and the message of hope that his provision gives to you. Unless we're telling the story, people aren't going to hear it. Unless we're sharing the good news and sharing the blessings we've received, they're never going to know that God provides still. God provides still more for us. And there's much more that he wants to bless us with. So I invite you, and I gave you the wrong, Kathy, the wrong page number. It's in the Bible. That's on me. Service of Word and Table 2. Some of the words are a tad bit different, and you'll see that as we go through the litany. Christ the Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you in our whole life. We have failed to be in the leading church. We have not done our will. We have broken our law. We have rebelled against each other. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from the joyful obedience to Jesus Christ, our Lord. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were still sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and prayers.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You have made from one every nation and people to live on all the face of the earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. He commissioned us to be his witnesses to the ends of the earth and to make disciples of all nations. And today his family and all the world is joining at his holy table. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to you, he broke the bread and gave it to his people, his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the whole world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with your church throughout the world, and strengthen it in every nation and among every people to witness faithfully in your name. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray as we have been taught. Our Father, one body of our Lord that was broken for us all. And likewise, his blood was shed for all the world. And we share from the one cup of Jesus the Christ. As we have been doing, we have a few options for you. You are invited to come forward as you are able to receive a piece of bread, dip it into the cup, take and eat in remembrance of what Christ has done. Or you may come forward to receive the cup and wafer, I guess it is. And we also have gluten-free for those in need of that. We want everyone to feel comfortable in how they receive this holy meal. But regardless of how you receive it, it's the remembrance of what Jesus Christ has done for the world. And that binds us together wherever we are in the world, whatever language we speak, whatever country we live in. It is Jesus Christ, the crucified and risen Lord and Savior, that binds the church family together. So as you receive today, or as you wait to receive, remember our brothers and sisters around the world. And remember how God provides so much for each and every one of us. And I want to remind you that this table of the Lord is open to all who wish to come and receive. You don't need to be a member of this church or a member of any church. You just need to believe in what Jesus Christ did on the cross. If you want to spend time at the altar in prayer, you are welcome to do so. And again, all are welcome.
Thank you.
continue to join with them in proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ and telling the world that God provides still more blessing for each and every one of us. God provides for all of our needs. And all of God's children said,
amen.
This time we're going to stand as you are able. We're going to sing verses 1 through 4 of I Come With Joy, and the fifth verse will be after the benediction. So let's stand and sing again. God's children said,
amen.